First over that side.
All right, do any of the commissioners have anything they'd like to say to or about the congressman?
Real briefly, I've got to tell this story. 1984, I was working at First Federal Savings and Loan, and you came into this room, if I'm not mistaken, and announced that you were going to be running for Congress and representing Alamance County. And I stopped by East Davis Street Pharmacy. Joe Barber had a relative, Felbert Barber, who owned East Davis Street Pharmacy. And I went in. He was a big Republican. He and I used to talk politics every day because I ate lunch there all the time. And I bought a pack of Lance peanuts in a little plastic bag, a little that you used to pour in Pepsis and Cokes and so forth. And I took my business card, stapled them to those peanuts. And I came in this room, and you were here. I'm pretty sure it was this room, if I'm not mistaken. And I handed you those peanuts. It was the first time I ever met you, and I told you that they were a good luck charm. And you told me years later down at the Paramount at a forum that you still had those peanuts. Now, I'm sure they're gone now. But anyway, I'm going to miss the heck out of you. Take care.
Any other commissioners? Thank you, Howard.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you all for making an old man feel very special. I thank you very much for that, Chairman.
The first item is our public comments.
Bye, folks.
Bye.
Bye. Howard, see you. Gary McFarland.
Morning, folks.
Good morning. Good morning.
My name's Larry McFarland. I live at 6840 Stockard Road, Graham, North Carolina. I'm here to hoping that you'll pass the resolution against this amendment that we have coming up on the ballot in November. This amendment was recommended by the North Carolina Conference of District Attorneys as a way to save money and move causes along more efficiently. Superficially, this amendment seems harmless. It appears to provide defendants with additional rights to choose a bench trial instead of a jury trial. However, deeper examination reveals that it undermines the judicial process intended by our forefathers. It leaves the door open to corruption and coercion and fails to protect the judicial safeguards set forth in our Constitution. This is a bipartisan issue. Every person, both defendant and victim, is entitled to due process. This indigent population is most likely to be impacted. This amendment affects every citizen. It removes the voice of the people from the rightful place in the judicial system. We are losing our constitutional rights at an alarming rate. In the interest of expediency, and we should not be willing to vote them away as it has done in our North Carolina legislature. The American jury has been a protector and protection of the lives and liberties of our citizens. The jury system protects our individual freedoms by prohibiting the government from taking us to prison unless it can prove to every single person on that jury that we have committed crime. This jury of our peers must not only be unanimous in their judgment, but must agree beyond a reasonable doubt the highest legal burden to our judicial system. The fundamental protection of the jury system allows each of us to go about our daily lives secure in knowledge that if faced with a criminal accusation, our liberties will ultimately be in the hands of our fellow citizens. Proponents of this amendment point out that 49 states have similar provisions, and that North Carolina should get with the times. This argument, however, is illogical. Just because others play with fire does not mean that we must follow suit. Prosecutors also have reason to pause over this proposed amendment. Unlike many other states that require a prosecutor's consent under the North Carolina proposal, the prosecutor has no ability to oppose the waiver of jury trial. However, some have expressed concerns that it will allow attorneys to judge shop.
Sir, that's your time. Little buzzer is your time.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
That's right.
Thank you.
We have good issues coming up later.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Cox.
I hope y'all like my coat too. You know, some 37 years ago, I raised both my hands and I said, I swear to God, I will support and defend the Constitution against all terrorists, foreign and domestic. I swore to God to that, my God. You know, people, I lost faith in man's religion a long time ago, but I never lost faith in God. People say, you don't have faith in this religion, so you don't believe in God. I don't lose my faith in God, period. Man will let you down. God will never let you down. First Amendment. I never thought that I would be here to this day, and have been for years now, exercising that First Amendment. I'll always use that First Amendment, and the sheriff will always use the Second Amendment. Always. Never confuse the two. Right, Sheriff? And you've seen things. God looks after me, don't you?
You're out of order again, sir. If you would read the rules to stand here and talk, you do not talk to other people in this room. Make your speech and sit down.
Well, you hate me, don't you?
You're out of order, Sheriff, if you would read this, gentlemen. Next on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Let me ask for commissioner's responses first. Any responses? Hearing none. Approval of the agenda. Do we have a motion to approve the agenda, which will include the consent agenda? Is a motion? Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Chairman, if I could mention under the manager's update, there is a proposed amendment to the Walmart agreement.
Yeah.
That I'll cover if that's okay with the board.
Yeah, okay, good.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. There's a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Let's see. Resolution in support of waiver opposed to a waiver of trial by jury. Vice Chairman Lashley.
I'm going to call at this time Howard Beatty. He's going to speak on this matter. Howard, can you come forward?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and the board, for the opportunity to speak. I think we best read the resolution so everyone knows what we're talking about. So I'll just read it into the record. Resolution in opposition to waiver of trial by jury amendment. Whereas the North Carolina General Assembly has enacted legislation which will cause to be proposed to the people of North Carolina on the 2014 general election ballot an amendment to Article 1, Declaration of Rights, Section 24, Right of Jury Trial in Criminal Cases of the North Carolina Constitution. And whereas all political and judicial power is inherent in and derives from the people. And whereas all lawful governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed. And whereas the proposed amendment will affect the ancient and fundamental right of trial by a jury of the people, and whereas the ancient system and right of trial by jury enshrined in the common law by the sign and seal of King John on the Magna Carta in 1215 AD has been termed the bulwark and palladium of English liberty. And whereas, as Americans, we are the heirs and beneficiaries of the English liberty and the English common law. And whereas Thomas Jefferson stated that, quote, "I consider trial by jury as the only anchor ever yet imagined by man by which a government can be held to the principles of its constitution," close quote. And whereas a jury of the people is the fundamental and primary means whereby the people give consent to any act of the government. And whereas a jury of the people is the last peaceful barrier against usurpation, tyranny, and oppression. And whereas in the North Carolina Constitution of 1776, the people made a Declaration of Rights. And whereas the Declaration of Rights of 1776 acknowledges the ancient institutions of the grand jury and the petit or trial jury in the following articles. Article 8, that no freeman shall be put to answer any criminal charge but by indictment, presentment, or impeachment. And Article 9, that no freeman shall be convicted of any crime but by the unanimous verdict of a jury of good and lawful men in open court as heretofore used. And whereas it is a fundamental principle of our common law system of jurisprudence that the people shall be judged by the people and not by any officer of the government. And whereas the proposed amendment, if ratified by a simple majority of the people, would make a fundamental change to our North Carolina Constitution and the Declaration of Rights, and allow a person charged with a crime to waive the ancient right of trial by a jury of the people. And whereas the people would thereby be deprived of their fundamental right and duty to act as the conscience and consentors of the community and the ultimate arbiters of the law and of the facts. And whereas the proposed amendment would introduce both the potential and incentive for corruption, coercion, conspiracy and collusion, bribery and extortion, and partial, preferential, and prejudicial abuses of power by agents of the government against the people. And whereas there is an inherent conflict of interest in the fact that judges, prosecutors, and all attorneys, as officers of the court, are dues-paying members of, are licensed by, and have loyalty to the North Carolina State Bar as a condition of their employment in the judicial branch of government. And whereas, in addition, judges, prosecutors, and attorneys, as officers of the court, who receive pay, privileges, and benefits from the government, have a fundamental, indefeasible, and irremediable conflict of interest in favor of the government and of the North Carolina State Bar, and against the inherent rights and interests of the people. And whereas the amendment would create opportunity and incentive for government agents to exert pressure on the poor, the powerless, and the politically unconnected members of society to accept a trial by judge and to waive the fundamental right to trial by jury. And whereas rich, powerful, and politically connected defendants could choose to avoid a trial by a jury of the people and choose rather to go before a judicial agent of the government likely to be favorable to them. And whereas justice and equity would not be served if the rich, powerful, and politically connected who have an undue or special influence are allowed to choose to go before a judge likely to be favorable to them rather than a randomly selected and impartial jury of the people sworn to uphold justice and equity according to reason and a good conscience. And whereas prudence indeed will dictate that constitutions long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, but only with and after due deliberation, discussion, and debate by the people. And whereas the amendment to allow waiver of trial by jury has not been fully and properly publicized to the people for their due deliberation, discussion, and debate, now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the undersigned people of North Carolina, find and declare the proposed amendment to be contrary and injurious to our system of checks and balances and the fundamental principles of constitutional and republican government. And be it further resolved that we, the undersigned people of North Carolina, shall retain our ancient, inherent, and constitutional right to judge both the people and the government. And be it further resolved that we, the undersigned people of North Carolina, hereby oppose ratification of the proposed amendment and the proposed changes to the Declaration of Rights. And be it further resolved that we, the undersigned people of North Carolina, will, with due diligence and with publicity in the media, warn others of the sovereign people of the threat inherent in the proposed amendment and advocate for a vote against on the November 2014 general election ballot. Thank you.
Has anyone got any questions?
Pardon me?
I was asking if anybody had any questions.
Oh, in the audience?
Or? Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Or anybody? I think.
I would like to ask a question, please.
Okay.
Mr. Bailey, I didn't hear it. I may have missed it. I don't hear it. Did you mention, does this resolution mention the fact that the final decision is not by the defendant, but if he chooses a bench trial, the judge can deny his choice? So it's what you heard about, this is a choice of the defendant, it's not true. And if you're going to let somebody sit in torment for 2 or 3 or 4 years before you bring them to trial, this is an awful choice. I can't understand why 104 representatives in Raleigh voted for it, and 47-0 senators voted for it. I can't understand that. People who wrote out, excuse me, I'm rambling, I'm talking, and I'm supposed to answer the question. Did you cover that in your?
That was not covered, Mr. Webster. That was not covered in here. It was quite long already. There are lots of reasons, I think, not to pass this amendment, but we didn't cover that. But I appreciate you bringing that up. That's just one more point, I think, that we need to consider.
Well, I'd like to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
I've done a lot of research on this as well, mm-hmm. and it doesn't make me an authority, and I'm not a lawyer, and I'm certainly not a judge. But of the 49 states that have this, now I called, is it Paul Stamm? Is that his name, Raleigh?
Yes, sir.
And he's with the House of Representatives, and he was really big in this, if I'm not mistaken. So I asked him something I had heard. Was it true that this particular amendment, if approved in North Carolina, that the prosecutors would not have to sign off on it? Because I had always heard that, since I've been looking at it, that I was gambling that I was right, and he admitted I was right, that the majority of the states, 37 of them, require that the prosecutors and the judge, as well as the defendant who's requested the waiver, agree.
and that if North Carolina passes this, that we would be one of 12, well, one of 13, that didn't require the prosecutors to sign off on it. And he didn't think that was a big deal, because he told me, I said, well, why didn't you at least get it into where it's been sifted through at least 37 states, doesn't necessarily make it right, but that required the prosecutors and to sign off on. He told me, he said, well, it just didn't come up. And he said, besides, he said, the prosecutors really didn't complain. Some did, but as a whole, they didn't. And he said that the DA and he was talking about the other thing you mentioned about shopping for judges, or that's come out in the debate. And he said he thought that was a moot point, because the DA controls the docket, and they would know what judges were there at certain times, and it really wouldn't be a lot of shopping, he didn't think. Now, what I want to ask you is, why do you think this is unconstitutional? I have to believe that you think it is, or you wouldn't be making such a charge on it. In 1930, there was a case decided, Patton versus United States, argued February the 25th, 1930, decided April the 14th, 1930. Now, I'm not a big fan of precedents, but if they're there, why not talk about them? It was a case where somebody was, they had one person out of 12 that was the jury. One person could not finish the trial. And so they went ahead and had it with 11. And the case was basically about the constitutionality of that. And in the syllabus of that case, it says, quote, the decision was, number four, there is no difference in substance between a complete waiver of a jury and consent to be tried by less number than 12. And I think, I think I read the wrong one in all honesty, but everything that I have read does not lead me to believe that this was anything but a right for the defendant to have the jury trial, that it really wasn't established so that the people could demand that people be tried by juries. That's in court case after court case, they have upheld waiver of jury trial. At the U.S. Supreme Court, they've upheld the fact that employers could waive jury trials, have a person sign a contract. If you went to work for us, you have to agree to jury waiver if something comes up. They've upheld that in court all across the United States for decades. So with all the precedents that are out there, federal and state, and the overwhelming majority at the federal level and at the state level, why do you think this is a loss of rights that would have been challenged to be settled by a Supreme Court? And it hasn't happened in 80 years. Or longer than that, over 100 years almost.
Actually, Commissioner Sutton, I think that the framing of the debate about rights is a bit deceptive, because we're not talking about what we need to be talking about, the fact that we have a government, by the consent of the governed, we delegate authority to our public servants, and this is a delegation of authority to the government, which in North Carolina we have not given before, and therefore I believe it should be fully deliberated, discussed, and debated before we pass it. And the fact is that this makes a bigger change than the last amendment, which simply defined marriage. This makes a bigger change, and yet it has received very little attention or publicity, and most people are going to go to the polls. A lot of people will not even have heard of it, and so they will not be making an informed decision, and therefore, on that basis alone, I think that we should move to recommend a no vote. If the General Assembly wants to bring this back next year, I'd be more than welcome to have that debate again. But let's have a full and open discussion. You, for example, I know, have read the School of Government paper. 34-page School of Government paper analyzing this whole thing.
Pros and cons.
That's right. That's right. So there's big issues. 34 pages of them by the School of Government.
Actually, I thought it was a fairly soft expose on the issue as far as...
Yes. Yeah, I agree with you, sir.
Mm-hmm. Let me read one paragraph out of this, and I'm going to be quiet because I'm not going to support the resolution. Okay? The fact that the people don't debate things, that's their fault. I mean, you know, it was at the Raleigh level, it went into committee, it came out. I mean, surely it was in the press. And in all honesty, and I praise you for it, if it hadn't been for you, we would even have known about it here locally, because people just didn't, they're not on top of the issues as they should be. But I think we're on top of them in Alamance County. But let me read this. This was done by her name is Becky Gray for the Carolina Journal, and I got everybody copies of this, April 2014. She basically is negative on the amendment. I'll be honest about it, but here's what she says in her, it's one little short paragraph. She says, the Sixth Amendment in the U.S. Constitution assures the accused in criminal trials, quote, the right to a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury. In federal courts, the right was extended in state courts in 1968, but in 1930, the U.S. Supreme Court held that a defendant could waive the right to a jury trial and agree to be tried by the court alone. In the 1970s, the court upheld the constitutionality of plea bargain waivers in lieu of jury trials. So, you know, I think she's being balanced. She's coming down really kind of negatively on it, but she's telling the history of this. And I think my question is do you think to do this that it's unconstitutional?
This changes our Constitution.
Do you think it's unconstitutional as far as it being a negative that needs to be settled by the U.S. Supreme Court again?
I think we're not communicating.
No, I think I'm saying
we're talking about changing the Constitution,
which is constitutional if it's approved.
That's right. It's constitutional to change the Constitution.
Right.
So it's not. It's the question of whether it is constitutional. It is constitutional to change the Constitution. I don't think it would be a wise thing to do, and you may disagree with me on that as far as the merits or demerits of the amendment. Certainly, it's constitutional to change the Constitution. Okay.
I don't have anything else to say.
Any other commissioners?
But does it make sense to me to change the constitutional and the laws of North Carolina for 2% of the people who uses it? I think that you get the good old boy system, and a judge is going to turn that person loose or be more lenient to them. I think we need to stick to the system of 12 people making a decision to be guilty or not guilty.
Thank you, sir. I agree with you there.
Anybody else?
Yes, sir.
John?
I was going to stay out of this. I think this is an issue that the public should decide. I think they should inform themselves and make the decision either to approve or not to approve this constitutional amendment. But I guess as an attorney, I somewhat resent the suggestion that the trial lawyers, the defense lawyers particularly, are judge shopping. Let's go back to the history. In all civil trials, district court, magistrate, and superior court, you have the right to waive your jury trial and have a bench trial at any time you wish. In criminal court and district court, you never have a right to a jury trial. All of those are heard by a judge, which is a bench trial. Now, you have the right to appeal to Superior Court and have a jury trial there. I just don't see, and oh, by the way, the district attorneys, as Mr. Sutton previously alluded to, they call the docket. They decide which cases are going to be tried on any particular docket. It's not the defense lawyer. It's 100% of the time the district attorney. So jury shopping does go on in criminal court, but it's by the prosecutor, not by the defense lawyer. It's just an impossibility because the district attorney chooses which cases are going to be heard or not, and he knows which judge is going to be sitting there. As Tim did, Mr. Sutton, I did the research as well. I read the Ms. Gray's article, the Patton case, which is a 1930 case that he alluded to. I read it, and then that was, Tim, it was actually 1968 instead of the 70s when the Dunking case was heard in the United States Supreme Court. It's a lengthy case. The United States Supreme Court went through that in great detail, and they agreed that it's a defendant's right, not the people's right, to be tried by your peers. I think that's been tried and over and over in the United States Supreme Court. I cannot support this motion for us as a county commissioner board to oppose the constitutional amendment. I think I can express my opinions publicly, privately, as an individual, but I don't think I have the right as a county commissioner to tell these folks how to vote. And I'm going to have to agree with Mr. Sutton.
Let me say, I am celebrating my 50th anniversary of passing the bar this year. At least 20 years of that 50, I was a defense attorney. And at one point, I was a Superior Court judge and held court in 51 of North Carolina's 100 counties. There were several occasions that I've run across where a defendant wanted to waive a jury trial and, of course, could not. And all of the judges knew that at that time. And there are reasons for that. There may, there are certain crimes that inflame juries, and they just don't even like the looks of that person standing there, pleading with them. But I do not see how in the world this is taking away a right. It is giving a defendant the right to do. He has to make that choice. He's represented by an attorney who, sure, that he may be a friend with the judge, he may be a friend with the DA, he may be friends with both of them. But he has a duty and a responsibility to represent that particular defendant in the best way that he can, no matter what. And if he doesn't, there are appeals, Court of Appeals, State Supreme Court, U.S. Supreme Court. I think a defendant should have that right. North Carolina already gives that right. The federal government, the federal courts in North Carolina, the entire state, a defendant has a right to waive a trial by jury. Or he can go ahead and demand the jury, just like it has been. And if that happens or passes in this constitutional amendment that's being proposed, I think, as John said, it's a right of the defendant and not a right of the public. And I just think it might expedite the court system, which is just totally, totally wrecked right now. You can ask the sheriff. He's got a jail full of people down there who have been waiting trial, murder suspects, for a couple of years. Still sitting in jail, haven't been tried yet. So with Tim and John, I would have to oppose this resolution now. Anybody else have anything else to say? Is there a motion?
I'll make the motion that we pass this resolution.
Is there a second? Hearing none, the motion fails. Thank you, Howard, very much.
Appreciate
it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
We know you're doing a great job. And
thank you, Chairman. Appreciate it.
I understand your position.
Yes, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Next item, Assistant County Manager.
Morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Brian.
I have a request this morning that the board consider and approve spending funds from the Capitol Buildings Capital Reserve Fund for the following projects. We have three projects that we're asking you to consider. One is to approve $17,900 for the replacement of three HVAC units at the Alamance County Board of Elections. Second project is a request to approve $10,159 for the replacement of an air handler unit at the Alamance County Jail. And the final project is a request to approve spending $19,081 for the replacement of carpet at the Alamance County Register of Deeds office. All of these projects have been bid. We've received multiple bids for each one of these, and these prices reflect the best bids that we were able to get. The total spending request for all three of these projects is $47,140. The current balance in the Capitol Buildings Capital Reserve Fund is $150,345. If you approve these three projects at these prices, our new balance in the Capitol Building Capital Reserve Fund will be $103,205. So at this time, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have about the project.
Any questions from the board? Is there a motion?
So moved. I make a motion to support it.
I second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Mr. County Attorney.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are getting ready to close the sale to Peak Resources of the property at 600 North Main Street and 217 College Street, as well as Woody Drive. And in so doing, we have discovered a slight problem with the city of Graham overlapping on the county property. And there's a map you should have in your packet. It's just two slight little pieces of overlap. The city of Graham is going to take this up tomorrow night and quitclaim that their interest in those two little strips to the county. So this resolution before you is to accept, anticipating they will do that, to accept that transfer of property so we can close the Peak sale on Friday at 1 o'clock.
Any questions? Hearing none, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Clyde. Sheriff.
Yes, sir. Good morning. Chairman, Commissioners, I appear before you today to ask that we be able to take from our SCAP funds, which is yearly, we receive a check from the government, and that's the State Criminal Alien Assistance Program, and I'm asking to take those funds and put them in our code 4320601, be putting $25,924 in that particular coded area. And then we have to pay Robert Siegel $4,666.32. And I'm asking that we be able to transfer out of 432601 $4,666.32 to 4320190 to be able to pay Robert Siegel. He's the one that does the collection for us at, for the State Criminal Alien Assistance Program.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
So moved.
I second it.
All in favor, signify by saying aye. Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Clyde. We have to have some fun, folks.
Be a dull board if we did.
Sheriff said it was always.
Of course, you're getting ready to lose a little bit of comedy on this end.
Good morning again. I come before you today asking for an amendment to the legal department's budget so that we can finish the brief that we have been working on now in the DOJ trial. We've spent a total of $451,099.22 as of September 30th, and I have about $56,261 in the budget remaining. And we're projecting additional expenses of about $95,000. And we hope that this will complete the brief. Unless something else comes up from the DOJ, we believe it will. Total expenses thus far in this lawsuit, $602,360.54.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Glad you have a report.
Yes, I do. I have a report on the DOJ trial, but before I do that, I'd like to mention that Brian Hagan and I have met with the Ralph Scott folks. You may recall last meeting, we agreed to give them that property with a reverter in it. The property's in worse shape than any of us knew, and they are going to come before you on October 20th and ask that we that this board approve a bid, sale of the property by bid without a reverter, much like we did with the O&E building. So I promised them I'd make that make you aware of that potential. And their board meets this week, I think, to decide if they're going to go that route. With regard to the DOJ case, we had a 9-day trial in August. Very interesting that having read 2,000 pages of trial transcript, that they didn't prove their case. That's why this brief is so expensive. Let me give you an example. The Judge Schroeder allowed them every opportunity to make their case, and they just couldn't do it. He allowed the DOJ to have a 2.5-hour closing statement, 2.5 hours. Normally it's 20 minutes. Now, let me give an example of the testimony that the DOJ attorney claimed was in the record at his closing. And I quote Mr. Songer, "There's testimony that Sheriff Johnson made a similar instruction over the County Central Communication System, or CCOM, informing an officer who had stopped the vehicle, if the driver was Hispanic, take him to jail." And the Songer then said, "Two different officers in this case testified to that, Judge, Officer Allen and Officer Randleman. But if you go through the record," here's what Lieutenant Allen said. Question from Mr. Volek of the DOJ. "Did you hear the sheriff come over the CCOM system and instruct officers to arrest Hispanics?" "No, sir." "Did you hear other sheriff's deputies talking about that incident?" "No, sir." And then Lieutenant Randleman, the question was, "Did the sheriff come over the radio and say, if he's Hispanic, take him to jail?" Randleman testified, "I heard a rumor. That's it. I couldn't tell you which officer said it. I just heard a rumor." Yet the DOJ claims that there is testimony from two deputies definitively saying that the sheriff said that. This is what we're faced with. We have 2,000 pages of this, and we're going through it with a fine-tooth comb, coming up with a brief that will point these discrepancies out to the judge. And that's why it's so time-consuming and so expensive.
How much time were, if they were given 2.5 hours, how much time were you, the defense given?
We finished ours up in about 45 minutes. They simply didn't prove their case. There are certain elements they had to prove, and in my opinion, they didn't prove their case. Of course, it remains to be seen if the judge has the same opinion that I do. He's a good judge. Our briefs are due on the 17th of October. We'll file them. He will read them, and has indicated he'll make a decision sometime late November, early December. But I will say Judge Schroeder is not one that writes 1 or 2 page opinions. The sheriff had a case just last week that was dismissed. It was a federal case. Judge Schroeder dismissed it. An inmate had sprayed himself with lice spray and had sued the sheriff, claiming that he was exposed to all these terrible chemicals. This is the kind of foolishness that we have to deal with from the sheriff's customers over there at the Gray Bar Hotel. But in that case, we made a motion to dismiss. Judge Schroeder wrote a 24-page opinion granting our motion. Most judges, that same afternoon, Judge Beatty dismissed a similar case with a 1-page opinion. Motion granted, case dismissed. Schroeder doesn't do that. He is a legal genius. He truly is. And he will take this case, study these briefs, and he'll write a good opinion that will withstand an appeal.
Any questions for Clyde? Thank you, Clyde.
Thank you, sir.
Finance officer report.
Morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board.
Tom.
I come to you seeking a motion concerning the selection of a commercial bank to handle the deposit accounts of the county. You may recall that at the end of May, I received your permission to send out requests for proposals to consider deposit services incorporating treasury services, a lot of updated online banking type services that the county currently does not use. Our criteria at the time, among others, was to limit the number of banks to those that had a physical presence in Graham due to the obvious proximity needs that we have to get to the bank on a daily basis. So we sent out 8 proposals. We have 8 commercial banks that have branches in Graham. We actually have 15 commercial banks in the county now, in addition to 4 credit unions and 1 savings and loan. So we have plenty of financial institutions to consider. Some of the criteria, of the 8, we got 7 proposals back. 7 of the 8 banks in Graham submitted proposals. They were all very good. Some of the criteria that Susan Roberts and I studied, the proposals were due back to us August 15th. We looked at, among other things, how the bank calculates what's called its earnings credit, what they internally give to us on the deposits. Not in form of interest, but Tim, you may recall, earnings credit to offset service charge for activity. And we do have a lot of activity. We looked at the bank's ability to do what's called a vendor analysis, make recommendations to us on how we should pay certain vendors. Should it be by check? Should it be by ACH transfer? Should it be by purchase card? Should it be by other means? We looked at their ability to provide treasury services, prepaid debit cards, what their credit card program looked like, their purchase card program, which is something new to us. We looked at the strength of the bank, how they were rated. We also looked at whether or not they would calculate our balance available for these charges on an annual basis or if it was just on a monthly basis. Our business of money is very seasonal. It goes up in August, we spend money. It goes up in December, we spend money. So that was very important to us. We also let all the banks know that whatever we recommend on the deposit services, it does not affect any future lending opportunities, whether that's to offer services as a bond underwriter, whether we get different installment notes. They're certainly all in the picture for that, as well as any investment opportunities we have. I also want to comment that during the course of this, we were able to close out. I've reported the BB&T lockbox that we had. We were collecting some of our tax revenue in a lockbox in Charlotte. A couple of reasons that we don't need to do this anymore, mainly because the state actually has taken over the collection of motor vehicle taxes. We were using that a lot for that. But in that process, it saves us about $3,000 a month. So that was well received. So with all that in mind, staff recommends that we go with the depository services for the county to go with Wells Fargo. They were very, very thorough in their approach to looking at our needs. They actually came in and talked to everybody in our finance department about their positions as it relates to collections, what's the best way to get money in, what's the best way to pay our bills. So with that in mind, I'll be happy to answer questions, but I am seeking a motion from the board that we go to Wells Fargo with our depository needs for the county.
Any questions for Tom?
Are there any interest rates quoted in these comparisons?
There are, Tim. The interest rates right now that we're seeing, though, are frankly nominal. We're seeing short-term interest rates of 0.1%, and they're all within a very, very
narrow band. They're all the same, basically.
Yeah, we actually have a lot of our investment money just parked at what's called the North Carolina Management Trust, which is more like a trust department that is authorized by the folks in Raleigh. We have some money parked there, but again, it's only 0.1% right now.
Are you going to leave that in that location, or are you going to move to Wells Fargo also?
That's considered an investment account, so we'll leave that separate from our deposit accounts. But from time to time, and one of the things we want to do, we think interest rates may start to rise second half of next year, then obviously those investment objectives will become a lot more important than they are now.
Yeah.
What we want to do is leave enough money in the wells account to pay for our activity charges, which is what we're doing now. We do not receive a service charge at this time.
Do you need a motion?
Yes, sir.
Let me ask one more question. Okay. Is this a two-year deal, or is it annual? Or
It's good until we do it again. You may recall this is the first time we've done it in about 20 years. But at the board's discretion, we can submit. There's no contract amount on that.
I was here when we moved it one time because we felt like one bank was had it too long. And we were trying to, Larry Sharp, I think, might have been chairman. But, yeah, we've done it since I've been on the board as far as moving it. I don't remember when. But, yeah, I support that.
Fair motion.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Late aye.
County manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple of things for you. There's been discussion from the board about the possibility of canceling our November 3rd morning meeting. Since that is the day before the election, I think there'll be some activity going on. So with the board's approval, we would cancel that morning meeting.
Any objections on the board?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Can I tell one thing?
Sure.
I knew this. I had heard we were going to waive this maybe with approval. So I got up this morning and I started thinking. I said, this is my last morning meeting. And I started thinking about the route. Because on my way here, on a lot of meetings, I started thinking about the drive from my house to here. And I started thinking this morning. I said, you know, this is my last trip to Graham at this hour in the morning, at least for now. And in all honesty, it felt pretty good. I ain't gonna lie to you. So I support that.
All right. And the next that we have in front of you is a resolution to amend the local economic agreement with Project Swordfish, which is the Walmart agreement. Originally, we had in our agreement a August 1, 2018 date for the approval or for the implementation of jobs and also investment. When they filed their One North Carolina fund, they had August 1 of 2019. So this would just change the date of that from 2018 to 2019. Graham and Mevin have already approved of this amendment. So this only pushing it back 1 year.
You need a motion?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, motion.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it. Any other comments from the board? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And I do want to mention at our next meeting, we will have our first employee of the quarter award recognized at the next meeting, and we're real proud of that process. So we'll have her here to recognize her publicly.
Anything else?
No, sir.
Any commissioner comments? I wanted to say one thing. Howard Coble has been a dear and supportive friend of mine almost throughout my career. And it's hard to see him retire. It really is. And that's all I have to say. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.